take him out. That would be great. Just wanted to welcome the church family as we're together again. It's good to be together. A good picture of what it's going to be like someday when we're in heaven. Some from every tongue, tribe, and nation. It'll be awesome. I heard an amen. Do you guys agree with that? Amen? It'll be pretty amazing. I wanted to draw your attention to a couple things this week. I know we usually have, it feels like a litany of things we want to make sure get communicated, but I want to highlight just a couple because, as Isaac mentioned, we have a lot going on this morning. And so the one I really want to make sure we just really focus on, and see this is right in front of us, is the Family Life's Art of Marriage. It is a conference that's coming up this weekend, Friday and Saturday, and it's not too late to register. Scott's been hitting this one pretty hard. He's been doing a lot of legwork behind the scenes, and he has a great team behind him to make that happen. It's the only one in the Northwest that's happening this year, and it is an amazing thing. It's Family Life and our church family and lots of other community churches pull our resources to make this happen. A good time to lift up the first institution God created, marriage, and to remember the design he had for it and how to keep it fresh and encourage each other in it. So I hope you've carved out the time, or if you know someone who would really benefit from being here, encourage them to come. Pass along to friends. There is childcare available. There is meals that are provided. So sign up. You walk away with some great resources as well to take home. So if you have more questions, talk to one of the tall pastors again. It's always a good way to remember that. If you really want to know something important, come to a short pastor. But if you know, just kidding, Scott. Talk to the tall pastor, and he'll get you some good information and answer any questions you may have as well. You can go to the church website to find out more. So we have a great music and media team, and the music team's up front, and they do an amazing job. Amen? And the second half of their team, usually, like, they hide in the back and they stoop down low between or behind the desk and the tables, and they try not to be seen and even less heard. But they work pretty diligently. And as you've seen, they've been making further upgrades to things on the website and music and media stuff that we just don't see because we just take advantage of it, and we're just blessed by it. For me, who's looking this way, something like a screen back here, that you're like, there's a screen back there? Yeah, there's a screen back there. So I'm not constantly doing this to you guys. Hey, what's up? You know, just those things when the bulbs go out, your stuff breaks, or I break something else, which I do a lot. They just work diligently. And there's a number of things they do that have just been getting better. And one of them is getting the sermons online sooner. And so if you like to watch the sermons online, they've been working really hard to make sure they're up by Monday. So if you're in a life group and maybe you weren't here on Sunday because you decided to go to Bedside Baptist instead, they will have the sermon up on Monday and you can, you know, watch it online. So go to the YouTube channel. You can sign up for that, or just go right to the website. You can stream it so you can listen to it later on while you're driving, or go to the website. You can watch the sermon. So take advantage of that. Thank you guys for all the ministry you do there. It's an awesome thing. If you want to be a part of that team and you have some gifting there, talk to the guys in back. They're always looking to expand their resource pool, especially as sometimes it gets a little bit thin. They're in the back. I can't see them. I know. Stand up. Where are you at? Stand up, guys. Oh, wow. No, don't stand up. Good. Good job. Keep your, like, down low, Masami's height kind of thing. All right. Our Tibetan outreach team is going out, and I know we've talked about it quite a bit, and it's exciting to see a dozen people ready to go to India again and talk about Jesus with folks like we do while we're here. And so we need the church family to continue to pray. We need the church family to give, but pray, because the church moves forward how? On its knees. And so Each of the team members is required to have at least 10 prayer partners, and they have all surpassed that. But what an amazing thing to know that God is moving and doing more than even years previous to this, the 15 years we've been doing this now, because God chooses this time to respond in a very unique way, a powerful way to you. And you're asking him relentlessly over and over again to see that more from other tribes and tongues will join us with many from the nations at his throne. So pray. Pray and give. If you have questions about that ministry, pick up and take home with you one of the guys that's on that picture or ladies that's on that picture up there. They're good slave labor too, but a lot of them will be available along with our special guest here in the back table after the church gathering today to answer any questions or maybe just to share and encourage you about what's happening in that ministry. A lot more in your bulletin. Please read it.
All right, if you have your Bibles, turn to Hebrews chapter 9. Denny's going to read for us. Why don't we stand again? I know you just stood, but stand again as we read this kind of long passage. But it's really important that we read it at least. So Denny, thank you.
Hebrews chapter 9. Now, even the first covenant had regulations of divine worship and the earthly sanctuary. For there was a tabernacle prepared, the outer one, in which were the lampstand and the table and the sacred bread. This is called the holy place. Behind the second veil, there was a tabernacle which is called the Holy of Holies, having a golden altar of incense and the Ark of the Covenant covered on all sides with gold, in which was a golden jar holding the manna, and Aaron's rod which budded, and the tables of the covenant. And above it were the cherubim of glory, overshadowing the mercy seat. But of these things we cannot now speak in detail. Now when these things have been so prepared, the priests are continually entering the outer tabernacle, performing the divine worship. But into the second, only the high priest enters once a year, not without taking blood, which he offers for himself and for the sins of the people committed in ignorance. The Holy Spirit is signifying this, that the way into the holy place has not yet been disclosed while the outer tabernacle is still standing, which is a symbol for the present time. Accordingly, both gifts and sacrifices are offered which cannot make the worshiper perfect in conscience, since they relate only to food and drink and various washings, regulations for the body, imposed until a time of reformation. But when Christ appeared as a high priest of the good things to come, he entered through the greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this creation, and not through the blood of goats and calves, but through his own blood. He entered the holy place once for all, having obtained eternal redemption. For if the blood of goats and bulls and the ashes of a heifer sprinkling those who have been defiled sanctify for the cleansing of the flesh, how much more will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish to God, cleanse your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? For this reason, he is the mediator of a new covenant, so that since a death has taken place for the redemption of the transgressions that were committed under the first covenant, those who have been called may receive the promise of the eternal inheritance. For where a covenant is, there must of necessity be the death of the one who made it. For covenant is valid only when men are dead, for it is never in force while the one who made it lives. Therefore, even the first covenant was not inaugurated without blood. For when every commandment had been spoken by Moses to all the people according to the law, he took the blood of the calves and the goats with water and scarlet wool and hyssop, and sprinkled both the book itself and all the people, saying, "This is the blood of the covenant which God commanded you." And in the same way, he sprinkled both the tabernacle and all the vessels of the ministry with the blood, and according to the law, one may almost say, all things are cleansed with blood, and without shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. Therefore, it was necessary for the copies of the things in the heavens to be cleansed with these, but the heavenly things themselves with better sacrifices than these. For Christ did not enter a holy place made with hands, a mere copy of the true one, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us. Nor was it that he would offer himself often, as the high priest enters the holy place year by year with blood that is not his own. Otherwise, he would have needed to suffer often since the foundation of the world. But now, once at the consummation of the ages, he has been manifested to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. And inasmuch as it is appointed for men to die once, and after this comes judgment, so Christ also, having been offered once to bear the sins of many, will appear a second time for salvation without reference to sin to those who eagerly await him.
Thanks, Danny. Let's pray. Lord, I'm so thankful for your word that we can look into it this morning, try to understand it. I just pray that your Holy Spirit will help us to learn from this difficult passage what it really meant for your son to be on the cross, shedding his blood. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, just like with last week, we have to understand something about the Old Testament, right? And we talked about that a little bit, and it's the same here in this passage. If we don't understand a few key things from the Old Testament, the book of Hebrews is going to be really tough, because the writer didn't write it to folks like us. He wrote it to Hebrews, right, who knew all this stuff. They saw it. They lived it. They saw a sacrifice in a temple and all that kind of thing, and we've never seen that kind of thing. We don't understand it. And, you know, Leviticus, like we talked about last week's pretty boring. You know, when I think of Leviticus, I think of sleep. That's what comes to my mind when somebody says Leviticus. When I was making this lesson, I remembered a funny story. I don't think Dan Bagley's here this morning. I didn't see him. Maybe he snuck in somewhere. But anyway, Dan's older brother, Tim's, told a story. I was like 10 years old. I'll never forget it. He was a logger, Tim was, just like Dan, and loggers get up really early in the morning, say like 3 in the morning, to do what they do. And so Tim had gotten up really early, and he had to make a parts run down to Swan Island. And he said he got almost to Swan Island and hit a red light, and he stopped, and he was the first car in line, and it just turned red. And he thought, I'm just going to take a quick little nap here while the light is red. And he said he woke up to a bunch of cars honking, and he looked in his rearview mirror. There was a whole line of cars behind him. The light was still red, and he was like, what's wrong? Finally, he figured out that he had slept through a number of cycles of that light, and everybody behind him was, you know, honking their horn. And I can kind of relate to that. I'm not a logger, but I also get up early in the morning to go to work because I have to commute, right? And so I get up early to meet, or not to meet, and all the traffic, no, to beat all the traffic. And so I get up early. Sometimes, especially by the end of the week, I can get pretty sleepy. And I'm embarrassed to even tell this story, but I was talking to a colleague, and I fell asleep in mid-sentence. And I remember waking up to this colleague looking at me, and I was very thankful that the rest of the department didn't call 911, because they could have easily thought that I'd had a stroke or something. No, I was just sleepy. So when I dream a lot in those times of my couch in a nice, warm blanket when I'm really sleepy. And when somebody says Leviticus, that's kind of what I think of, is sleep and getting a nice nap. But it's important that we understand a few simple things. And it has to be important that there was a tabernacle prepared. Because just thinking of it this way, somebody had to write all that stuff down, right? And they didn't have printing presses in those days. And so somebody, if they wrote it and they had to make a copy, somebody had to write that. I mean, it's one thing to read it and how boring it is. Just think about having to write all that stuff. And all that was transferred all these years. You know, it's been like 4,000 years since this stuff was written and it's been preserved. I mean, there's nothing in the world like this that's been preserved for us. And so it had to be important. And so if God made sure all of that stuff stayed, there must be some importance to it. And so this tabernacle he talks about, if you go back to Leviticus, there were, just really quick, I probably should show you a picture, but there was a square, and I remember this because, and I know some of this because my mom taught children's church when I was a kid, and she made a tabernacle, not a real one, but a fake one, a model, and we did all the rituals and everything. I remember that. So it was like rectangular, and there's two rooms, and the first room had a showbread, a golden lampstand, and an altar of incense. That was in that first room, and then there was a veil, and behind that room was the Holy of Holies, and that was the Ark of Covenant that had the manna that the writer speaks of. And then outside that rectangular building then was the altar that they sacrificed on, and there was also a washing bin thing, water holy or something, that they did on that outside part, right? And what you'll see is if you go back to these verses is that it was a pretty bloody thing. Can you imagine? Because they every day they were sacrificing day and night some kind of animal. And I'm thankful that, you know, we don't have to do this law thing, because I don't think Peter'd be very happy with this whole law thing, because they killed a lot of animals and it was bloody. I mean, could you imagine if we had to sacrifice, slay an animal every Sunday morning? I mean, we would not be pretty. But it might get the point across, though, at the same time, because it was really bloody. And the thing is, we can kind of picture this, slaying of an animal, but just think about what it smelled like. Oh, it's just been terrible. That whole place just had to have stunk and flies and it was just gross. And we kind of put a pretty picture on it, but it wasn't pretty, I don't think, because they sacrificed a lot of animals. Two animals every day, and then the second thing that they did is if a person sinned unintentionally, which is the next verse there, unintentionally, that any of the long, remember last week, the long list of commands, if you did unintentionally any of these things, then you had to bring a guilt offering and they would slay the animal and do the blood thing. So when I read this, because I'm not a scholar at this kind of stuff, trust me, and so I read this like, whoa, wait a minute, unintentional? So what happens if it's intentional? What if you just said, hey, I'm going to wear a kilt. I don't care what the law says. I'm going to do it. Yeah, if you turn to Numbers, it was not pretty. You just got kicked out. There was no sacrifice for you. It was pretty harsh, this whole law thing, by the way. So if it was an unintentional, then you slayed. And then once a year, Aaron would, the priest, it started out with Aaron, but all the priests, the first thing they would do is they would do a bull, which is the next verse, Leviticus 16 there. They would do a bull for himself, and he would take that into the Holy of Holies, and he would sprinkle that blood onto that Ark of the Covenant. And then, by the way, this is just a fun fact to know, they would have little bells in case the guy, and I think, do they have a rope? I'm not a scholar of this thing, but in case the guy croaked over and had a stroke, they pulled him out, because nobody else could go in the Holy of Holies, or they were, kind of thing. So he would go in and sacrifice for himself, and then he would do a goat then for the people, once a year, he would go into that. But it was just temporary. In Hebrews chapter 9, it talks about that. It was just a temporary substitute for these outward laws. It didn't really do anything inside. It was just kind of a covering. We talked about that last week. It was just kind of a covering, a temporary thing until something could really be done about it, which is what Christ did. He did something about it. He was that priest. It all starts to come together, right? Remember that boring chapter? I'm sorry, Masami, I shouldn't say that boring chapter that you did with Matizadek. It wasn't, the chapter was boring, okay? So the chapter was boring and it doesn't make any sense, but it starts to come together here because he had the right to go into this, to the real tabernacle. It wasn't just like a copy of, it was the real tabernacle, and he took his own blood in Hebrews chapter 9 there when Christ appeared as the high priest. He entered through a greater, more perfect tabernacle. You know, in the first, the previous chapter, the writer says that when God came to Moses, he said, you need to do this exact. Be careful to do what I tell you, because what Moses probably didn't understand is that he was making an exact copy of what was in heaven. And I find that fascinating, that there really was a physical, evidently a physical temple, or is a physical temple in heaven with an ark, just like God had made Moses do, that was in heaven. And it wasn't the blood of goats and calves, but it was his own blood that he took in. That's a kind of a long passage, and we don't have much time this morning. I just want to point out five things in that passage from verses 11 through 14. Five things. He was a worthy priest, the first thing. That's why the writer talks about all in Melchizedek and all this other stuff, because he wanted us to understand that he was worthy. He had every right to go into to that priest. His blood was, he was guiltless. He had never sinned. It wasn't a copy. It was the real thing, and he was a worthy priest. The second thing, it was a true tabernacle. It wasn't built by hand. You know, I've always, you know, I have a shop, and I try to build stuff. Key word is try, right? Because nothing's ever perfect. And my wife hates that nothing's ever perfect that comes out of that shop. I mean, I try so hard, but I can't make it perfect. But that tabernacle was perfect in heaven. It's exactly what God had in mind. It was perfect. Third thing, as we've already talked about, that it was his own blood. It wasn't the blood of an animal. It was his own blood. And he did it once. You know, every year that priest had to go back in there and give his blood, but when Christ did it, it was once and for all, for eternity. And you know what? I wish I could be in heaven and understand all that went on and all that stuff, but you tend to think that it was something that God had in mind for eternity past. I mean, you start to think about that. That's amazing that he had eternity past. I don't know what he was doing all that time, but whatever he was doing, he had something in mind, that his son would hang on a cross in Judea in this little tiny part of our universe. That's almost shocking that God would do that. He did it once. And that was it. And it's true redemption. See, and it doesn't like our sins are covered anymore. They're taken away. And what's so amazing about the last part of that verse is that's how we really can be servants of his. Because otherwise it seems to imply that it's all for naught what we do. But when we have true forgiveness and God takes our sin away, we can truly serve him. It's like he's commissioning us to serve him, to serve the God of the universe. It's like the President of the United States coming and says, I want you to serve on my cabinet. I think I would turn that down. Maybe that's not a good example, but maybe if it was a king and you lived in the second century and the king says, I want you to be in my court, that would be amazing. And that's what this is kind of like. Because of what Christ did, he takes our sins away and he commissions us to be able to serve him. Next thing is that he was a mediator of a new covenant. Look at this verse. For this reason, he is the mediator of a new covenant, so that since the death has taken place on the redemption of the transgressions that were committed under the first covenant, those who have been called may receive the promise of eternal inheritance. For it is a covenant, there must be a necessity to be the death of the one who made it. See, it's kind of like a will. That's what the writer says. He doesn't say will, he says a covenant, but for us it would be a will. So if my dad had a will, and it didn't really matter what that will was until my dad died, right? Because it really wouldn't be administered until he died. And that's what the writer is saying, is that Christ had to die first for that covenant to be real for us. Otherwise, it wouldn't. I don't really understand all that stuff. And maybe someday I will, but somehow that covenant wasn't enacted until Christ had died. Without his death, it couldn't be. And that promised inheritance, that will, so to speak, is eternal life. And we can be guaranteed that through the death of his son. And you know what I like about this? It isn't just like some of us can just take that as blind faith. You know, they say, he said it. I'm going to do it. But some of the rest of us, you know, we got to have a little bit behind that. And that's what I love about the scriptures. It doesn't give us everything by any means. We can't see, but we get a glimpse. And there's a glimpse there, and you can go as deep as you want. You can go as deep as you want to know that it's really true and be convinced. It's not just a blind faith, but a faith that has something to it. And that's what the writer is saying. Hey, we can look back at this, Melchizedek and all these other things, and the law, and we can see it come together and say, this must be true, that he really was the priest that had the right to go in and shed his blood for us. And finally, without the shedding of blood, there is no remission. See, now some of you have that verse memorized, right? You probably memorized that as a kid. But now you know the context of that verse, right? Because we're studying this entire chapter. Therefore, even the first covenant was not inaugurated without blood. And then he goes on to say that everything was really bloody. They spread it everywhere. They put it on their Bibles and on their stuff, and it was just everywhere. Can you imagine here in America today, if I went around spreading blood everywhere? I mean, you'd just be saying, you're sick. There's something wrong with you. But they did that everywhere because it was a reminder. God didn't have to do that just because he just wanted to gross them out. He did it because there was a reason. There was a reason. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission. Sometimes I wonder if we just don't think that God just kind of is letting us off. I wonder, I know we, most of us don't think that, but sometimes I just kind of wonder if that doesn't creep in our mind sometimes. That God just wasn't saying, hey, you know what? These people aren't that bad. Maybe I mentioned this last week, but, you know, there's a lot of good people at my work that don't know Christ. They don't know the Lord, you know, and they're good people. And I've often think, you know, it's like, is God really, you know, are they really going to hell? And that's a tough one to swallow. I'm just going to tell you that. That's really tough to swallow. And sometimes I think the problem is that maybe we try to put lipstick on sin, kind of like lipstick on a pig. We put lipstick on sin, and we try to just gloss over it. It's so hard to think about it. I don't like to think about my own sin. You know, it's not something I really like to talk about. I wonder sometimes if that isn't kind of the problem. Is that we don't, in just life, we kind of miss it of how egregious sin is. And I think the first thing, the reason why, is that we have a tendency to look at others, not at ourselves. We're experts at our friends and family, especially our family. You know, we can pick up everything that's wrong, you know, with our family. And we may even have some really good solutions for our family and friends too, as to how to get things straightened out. If they could just do, well, like me, you know, kind of thing. And our own shortcomings, we're not so good at seeing our own shortcomings. When we come by it, honestly, by the way, it's not something that just got made up. You know, after Adam and Eve sinned, they did the apple thing with the tree. It's interesting if you kind of study how they reacted to God. And I have this verse here. And I think God has kind of a sense of humor, too. That's what I think. Then the Lord God called to the man and said to him, "Where are you?" Isn't that kind of weird? I mean, they just sinned. I mean, they kind of ruined it for all of us, right? And here's God saying, because I'm not so sure that if I had to, you know, try to make up the story. So, Tim, what do you think happened after Adam and Eve sinned? I don't think I would have God in the garden say, "Hey, where are you?" I'd have God like, "Okay, please come forward. You have just sinned," kind of thing. But that's not, "Hey, God, where are you?" And Adam's like, what did they say? "I heard the sound of you in the garden. I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid myself." He said, "Well, who told you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree?" Now, watch what the man says. The man says, "The woman who you gave me, by the way, she gave me and I ate from the tree." Right? There was no like, "Oh yeah, God, I know you, I know you commanded us not to eat that apple thing. I don't know what happened. My bad. You know, protect my wife here that you get." No, it's, and really what he's doing is blaming God. Right? "The woman that you gave me, by the way." Have you ever done that? And you know, the verses before, he was pretty satisfied with what God had done, right? God had been pretty good. And it's just amazing how quickly things can turn, right? And maybe I'm the only one, but when things go wrong, I've been known to do that. "Lord, what is with the black cloud here? I don't understand. I don't get it. And I'm really kind of mad about it right now at you, God." Thankfully, we serve a wonderful Savior. A wonderful Savior. Because if you've ever said that, you know, it's not all over. It's not like the guy who unintentionally in the law sinned. Thank God. You're not excommunicated if you've ever had those thoughts that, "Hey, God." You know, there was somebody else, Peter. He had a little trouble, remember? He denied he even knew Christ. I mean, it's kind of different, but kind of the same, right? Three times. And he had said, "I'll go to death for you," to Jesus. And Jesus, yeah, by the time the crow, you know, and you know the story, and just, "Whoa, no, not me, not, you know," because so he even had the boasting that he would, you know, follow Christ to the death, yet he's denying Christ that he even knew him three times. Jesus raises from the dead. He comes and has breakfast with the disciples. The best breakfast probably ever put on a beach. And I can't even imagine what that tasted like. It must have been awesome. And after breakfast, he asked Peter, "Do you love me?" Peter says, "Yes, I love you." And a second time, and a third time. And he said to him a third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" And Peter was grieved because he said to him a third time, "Do you love me?" He said to him, "Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you." Jesus said, "Tend my sheep." We serve such a wonderful Savior. Oh, isn't that amazing? For those three times he denied him, Jesus needed him and Peter needed to hear himself say, "You know that I love you." That's the kind of Savior we serve. Even if we've denied him, even as a Christian that we've denied him, or been mad at him, or said, "Look at this woman that you've given me," there's still forgiveness. Second thing is that there's a tendency to compare. So I'm doing pretty good, especially concerned if you compare me to my cousin Fred, or the guy across the street, or that poor person that's just really, you know, not getting their act together. Compared to them, I'm doing pretty good. So God will certainly be impressed with me because I'm doing pretty good compared to everyone else. What's pretty good? And I thought of this illustration, and I hope you understand it. If you're not a car person, maybe you won't. I don't know. But for me, this is what came to mind when I was thinking about this whole aspect of comparing. So my last day of my graduate studies, my wife bought me a new car. And if you know anything about Colleen, some of you do, you know that's perfectly plausible that my wife would go to a dealership and buy me a car on my last day of my graduate studies. She bought me a WRX, you know, one of those Subaru things, and it goes pretty fast, Yeah, 0 to 60 in car and driver, 5.1 seconds. That's pretty fast. And the reason why is all-wheel drive, so it gets off the line pretty fast, okay? Now, let's say I was comparing my car to your car, and you had a smart car. You know, one of the little things? Yeah, all 90 horsepower. Yeah, I looked it up. Smart car will, yes, by the way, will go 60 miles an hour. First of all, that's the first thing we need to clear up. 0 to 60 in 10.3 seconds, and the WRX is 5.1, so that's double, right? Wow, you know, I just chalk one up, right? If I'm comparing, right? You know, I can almost, you know, 0 to 60, stop, come back, go to 0 to 60 again, you know, and still maybe be ahead. Wow, I could be pretty proud of myself, you know, having a car that would go that fast compared, of course, to the smart car. They park those darn things. I used to drive my diesel Dodge to work. I don't drive it to work much, but they park those things right behind me. And, you know, I don't have a backup mirror in my truck. I can't see those little things in my mirrors. It's like, of course, they've never, I'm sure, driven a diesel Dodge, but, and they wouldn't know. But anyway, and I don't think I've ever run one over, but I'm not sure I would even know. So let's say, back to the story, I'm off my notes and I'm out of time. So back to the story. So let's say my third friend, is a Navy fighter pilot, and his morning commute is an F-14 off the end of a aircraft carrier, okay? So I looked it up. You know, that's not information that's readily available. The government doesn't really like giving out information about how fast their jets are. But I did find a paper on doing a new type of, what's the thing that bursts them off? The catapult. Yeah, they're doing about 165 knots off the end of the aircraft carrier. It's 190 miles an hour. Now, they're 0 to 60 times. Admittedly, I couldn't find that. But if you extrapolate, and I know that's dangerous, but if you take it as linear, it's about a half a second, 0 to 60. And I know there's a catapult, but just follow me with the story, okay? So, yeah, 0 to 60 in half a second. Wow, I couldn't even hardly pop the clutch in half a second. That's like 10 times and 20 times more than the smart car. So if that's the criteria, and let's just say that is then becomes the criteria, well, what's the use of comparing the smart car and the WRX at that point? What's the point? They're both really slow. Right? How is that any different than us? Look at this verse in Isaiah. For all of us have become like one who is unclean, and all of our righteous deeds are like a filthy garment. Now, you probably heard that verse, right? And you think, yeah, I'm not on my bad day. Yeah, it just doesn't compare well, my bad day, you know, when I can't find my keys and I'm, you know, beating things like a five-year-old, kind of, you know, one of those instances. It's not good, but that's not what the verse says. Even on your best day, you think about it, your best day, and you don't even measure up at all. You haven't even popped the clutch yet. Christ is way off the end of the career by the time you even think about starting. See, it's all a matter of perspective of what you're comparing to. His glory is beyond anything that you could ever dream. Yeah, comparing it to Christ is like putting my WRX on the deck of the carrier. What an absurd thing. right? To try to say, I'm going to race this F-14 Tomcat. It's going to be awesome. I mean, it's just like ridiculous. And my WRX doesn't fly. So when I get to the end of the deck, it's at the bottom of the sea. I mean, it's just absurd. Why is it that we think we can measure up to Christ? We can. Even at his best, we can't compare to his glory. You know, sin has a consequence. Sin has to be taken seriously. It was so serious that God sent his own son for eternity past on that day to be born of Mary, to grow up, to die on a cross. That's how serious it is. Watch what happens when Isaiah is confronted with his glory. Because Isaiah went into the throne room and he sees God's glory. It's all bright and all these cherubim and all this stuff. And the fountains of the thresholds trembled at the voice of him who called out, that's Christ. While the temple was filling with smoke, then I said, woe is me, for I am ruined. Because I am a man of unclean lips. And this is no chump here. This is Isaiah. And the first thing that he saw when he saw the glory of God was his own sin. Reminded of that song you hear on the radio, Will You Dance for Jesus or whatever. And I'm like, oh my word, I hope not. Because I can't dance. I mean, I got the rhythm of a block of wood. I mean, that would be the comedy hour for me to have to dance in front of Jesus. I'm not so sure that's very scriptural. Thank God. Because I think I'll be on my face like Isaiah because of my own sin and my own humanity compared to his. If you're going to have any chance, the parameters have to be changed. See, we could take Bob's dragster, and it's still not going to compare, right, to the F-14. You have to change the parameters. You can't use an internal combustion engine. It's not going to work. And that's what this priesthood stuff's all about. Christ changed the parameters for us. He changed the parameters because all things are cleansed with blood. We understand that. But it was his own blood. Somebody had to pay. And Jesus paid it for us. And shed his blood, he did. You know, he could have just taken a pill. Because Jesus had the technology, by the way. Maybe they did in that century, but he had the technique. He could have just taken a pill, lethal injection, went to his disciples, said, okay, it's all over. See you in 3 days. Took a pill, died, and that would have been that. But that's not what he did. That's not what we have recorded for us. He gave himself up. I think when we get behind the scenes, we're going to see that Satan was behind all of this. This was his glory right here. He had Jesus, the Son of God, in his hands, and he could do whatever he wanted. I think he spent centuries making stuff up, like crucifixion and scourging and all this stuff, because he knew someday he'd have Jesus in his own hands. And it was brutal. And I think the politics were involved. See, I get all into this politics, you know, and the history of this, and the Romans. And, you know, guys like Pilate didn't really have that much power. And they were always afraid it was going to be taken away from them. And the Jews were hard to control. They were always getting out of control. And he knew if they did, he would lose his power. And he knew something was up. He knew that Jesus was innocent. Look in John 18. Look at what he says. Then he said this. And when he had said this, he went out again to the Jews and said, I find no guilt in him, because he interviews him. He knew that he was innocent. And what's so fascinating about that passage is how Christ reacts. That he's talking to Pilate one-on-one. He's about to be scourged and crucified. And he's talking to Pilate because he's concerned about, just like he is concerned for us, his eternal redemption. And as a result of this, Pilate made efforts to release him, but the Jews cried out saying, if you release this man, you are no friend of Caesar. I think what was up there is that Caesar was going to beat the crap out of him, put him out in front of all these Jews, and certainly, surely they would be satisfied, and he wouldn't have to send him to the cross. I've got a book here. I was going to read from it by a physician. That has written a book about what happened to Christ. I get into this kind of stuff, not the brutality, but just the science behind it. And I was going to read a passage, but my wife's side said, no, you're not. And I appreciate her because she's probably has saved me. Because see, I just get into this about the arteries and all this. She said, that's brutal. You can't read that. Suffice it to say, when they put that crown on his head, he bled. We all know what happens with head wounds. They bleed, and they don't stop. I was walking around with a ladder, with a hammer up on the top of the ladder. Why are you laughing? Yeah. Hammer falls off the ladder, hits me in the head. You know, hurt like crazy. Oh my gosh. And see, and I whenever I do something that hurts me, I just keep doing whatever I'm doing to get my mind off of, you know, what I'm doing. And then about 2 minutes later, I'm like, whoa, whoa, what's that? Oh, blood just, you know, coming down the side of my head, you know, from the wound. Had an oil rag there, just kind of made it, you know, fine till I could get home, that kind of thing. But yeah, it bleeds and it doesn't stop. And this physician goes into why that is. He shed his blood. And then they scourged him. And they, you know, they take that whip with the bone and the metal in it, and they just, you know, just makes hamburger out of your back. And most likely those slashings went all the way to the arteries and burst them open. And he bled. And was it some figment of, hey, he shed his blood like he died? No, he shed his blood. You say, how do you know? I mean, you know the crown and all of that, but how do you really know that? Well, we know that from this story because he couldn't even carry his own cross. You know, that wasn't necessarily the way they did it, the Romans. They didn't necessarily almost, you know, kill somebody and then put them on the cross. Sometimes on the cross, guys would last like 4 days. He was so weak and so near death, but he couldn't even carry his own cross. And he only lasted a few hours on the cross because he had taken so much in that previous 24 hours. For you and for me, I deserve to be on that cross. I deserve to get that beating. I deserve that crown. That's amazing. The God of the universe would do that for me. Couldn't carry his own cross because he was so weak. He'd lost so much blood. I love this country. I know that's politically incorrect to say, but I love this country and all it stands for. You know, the fact that I can stand here and preach the gospel to you, that's an amazing thing that we should never take for granted. I'm reading a book or listening to a book right now about the revolution. Do you know that the guys that fought, they didn't even have shoes? The historians say that you could follow where the army had gone because the blood and the snow, because the guys' feet were bleeding as they marched. So I could stand here in freedom. Take it for granted. It's just human nature. We just take it for granted. And that's nothing compared to what Christ has done for us. We just get involved in life. Life happens. God's so good to us. It's in the good times that it's dangerous that we forget Jesus knew that. He knew that we'd have a propensity to forget. You know, with all that law and all those things that he had in the law, there was only two things that he really commanded. Maybe three. Follow me, be baptized, and take communion. You know why? Because he knew that we would forget. And he gave us just two little simple things to do, a cup and a piece of bread. It's physical, though. It's something we can take in our hands. We can physically drink it and eat it in remembrance of what Christ did. Because we can't forget. We just can't forget what he's done for us. Because if we remember, it affects us. Because there's two things that happen when I read the account of what Jesus went through. The first thing is the Scott Irish in me just raises up and I want to go, what's the guy's name that was in that movie? I just want to go Braveheart on everybody involved. And then the second thing is I just want to serve this Christ that did so much for me. And that's why it's so important that we not forget. We do things a little bit different here at First Baptist. If you're a visitor with us or you've not been here during communion, we do it a little different by you can just come and get the elements whenever you want. In the three songs that the worship team's going to come back up and do. And what that enables you to do is you can go as a family and pray together or and you could go in the back or sometimes I just do it in the back. We're crowded today, so it's probably maybe in the foyer or whatever. You just pray together. And then those are such special times. I really appreciate it because this was a new thing for me, right? You know, new things are always, what? This is kind of weird. You know, that's my first reaction. But now that we've been doing it, it's like, I really appreciate it. Because I can go back with my family and pray and remember what Christ has done for us. So with that, let's pray. Lord Jesus, there is no way we can understand fully the importance and the significance of what happened that day. Jesus, you being tortured and beaten for our rebellion and sin, we thank you today that at least through your word and the power of the Holy Spirit, we can at least have a glimpse of not only your glory and holiness, but what you've done for us. Lord, help us through the power of your Holy Spirit to always be grateful in the tough times, but especially in the good times. Help us to not forget what you have done for us, especially this morning as we take communion. Make it meaningful to us. Lord, I pray that every single believer here this morning will choose to worship you as they take that cup and that bread. As the psalm declares, your loving kindness is everlasting. Lord, give us the ability through the Holy Spirit to declare that this morning. In Jesus' precious name, amen.